So is my screen visible? Okay. So yesterday we have seen the concepts such as the introduction to the blockchain. Then we have seen how the addresses are generated in the Bitcoin. And not only in Bitcoin, in any cryptocurrency, how the addresses can be generated and how the public key and private key pairs will be generated. And in this, we have seen the famous elliptic curve cryptography is used in the Bitcoin and the Ethereum blockchains. And for this, there is a recommended elliptic curve called specification 256 K1 elliptic curve. That will be used for generating the addresses, private keys and public keys. And with small example, we have seen how to generate the public keys. And since ECC is providing flexibility to choose whatever the private key you want, so it is very easy for you to remember the private key. The reason is you are supposed to choose whatever the key you want. So with that, how to generate the, sorry, how to go for the encryption and how to go for decryption, then how to generate our own keys once you know a seed key, like with the help of point addition, point doubling. Okay, these are the concepts that we have seen, and we have had a discussion on the cryptographic hash functions. Okay, in elliptic curve cryptography, yesterday someone asked regarding the Diffie-Hellman elliptic curve. Here, because since you are Diffie-Hellman elliptic curve is especially used for exchanging of the keys in an unsecured environment, but here, since you are the one using the application and you are supposed to create the account, automatically this keys will be allotted to you. So here there is no key exchange will be there. So if any key exchange to be performed in the unsecured environment, then Diffie-Hellman key can be exchange can be used, that you can refer in any renowned textbooks. Okay, but for the time being we don't require this Diffie-Hellman key exchange here. So yesterday I forgot to tell that, so that is reason yesterday when I am recalling all the things, so today I want to convey this message. Okay, next is cryptographic hash functions that we have seen. In that especially SHA-256 hash function will be used. SHA-256 is a very powerful hash function, and the Bitcoin uses the double hashing method. It won't use the single hashing method. It will use double hashing. That means whatever the transaction data is there, that will be given as the input to the SHA-256. Thereby, you will get a hash code, which is a 256-bit hash code. And that particular 256-bit hash code again sent on to the 256-bit, 256, sorry, SHA-256. Thereby, you will get a new hash code. This is what we call double hashing. So, this Bitcoin will use the double hashing method. Next one is the digital signatures. So digital signatures are the things that are especially used for maintaining the non-repudiation property. Non-repudiation property is nothing but a sender in a later stage, he cannot deny that he has not sent the message. So this is the this can be ensured with the help of digital signatures. We have seen in the yesterday's lecture, that is the public key and secret key pairs, both keys can be used for encryption and decryption. So in the signature part, what we do is the transaction data that what we want to secure, that will be placed on the SHA-256 function, and we'll get a hash code. That hash code will be signed with the private key of the sender, so that by knowing the public key of the sender, anyone can verify that whether he has really sent the or initiated the transaction or not. So in this way, non-repudiation property can be achieved in the digital using digital signatures. Next one is a Bitcoin case study. We have seen the Bitcoin case study with respect to mining difficulty, how the mining difficulty will be calculated. We have seen the formulas. And how it will be calculated? Can anyone tell me that how the mining difficulty will be calculated? How the current difficulty will be calculated? Current difficulty is equal to? Current difficulty is equal to? Does anyone listening? Yes, please answer. How the difficulty will be calculated? Okay, nobody is answering. Hello. Yes, participants, please respond. How the current difficulty will be calculated? Madam, is it audible? But no one is responding. So I'm asking this question that how the difficulty in the Bitcoin mining will be calculated. So the Bitcoin difficulty, mining difficulty is calculated like current difficulty is equal to the previous difficulty into number of milliseconds in 2 weeks by the number of milliseconds taken to compute last 2016 blocks. So with this, the difficulty value will be can be calculated, and this difficulty value will be used with respect to generating the number of hashes. So we have seen the hash rate versus difficulty concept in that some formulas we have seen. Then we have seen the concept such as cryptocurrency metrics. In this cryptocurrency metrics, how the fork can be, what is the probability of occurring the fork, and the inter time, that is the system time, and with respect to the bandwidth and the computation power. See, all these metrics we have seen in that particular topic. So these are the topics mainly discussed in the previous day. So today I am mainly focusing on the concepts such as how to choose blockchain projects, okay, how to choose blockchain projects, setting up the blockchain environment like IBM Hyperledger, Ethereum. As we have seen in the yesterday's model curriculum, IBM Hyperledger related programming lab was there recommended to establish for the as part of the course. So IBM Hyperledger, Ethereum. Next is you can do in a separate environment, or you may do these things by in the Ubuntu operating system by setting up a virtual machine side by side on top of your regular operating system. It may be Windows 10 or any other thing. So how to set up that virtual machine and how to install these softwares in that and this kind of explanation I'm going to give. Next is Hyperledger application, how to start the Hyperledger application and how to work on that. Then I will give the introduction to the Ethereum and smart contracts in Ethereum, and general introduction to the Solidity programming, and what are the suitable integrated development environments where you can develop the smart contract and test it, that I am going to discuss using Remix IDE. And there exists another IDE that which is a command based IDE called Truffle IDE, that also I am going to discuss. Next is Web3JS, where how these particular smart contracts can be connected to the front end applications. So that I am going to see, I am going to discuss in this Web3JS. Then finally, I will throw some light on the research directions that are there in the blockchain. But I cannot go in deep of all these topics. But however, I will provide sufficient information so that you can take it further for your regular work or teaching work. So first, we'll start with the how to choose the blockchain projects. The participants, in middle, I will ask some questions also. Please respond. Otherwise, how I know that whether you are listening or not? So it is very difficult for me to proceed further without knowing that how far you have understood. Okay, it is okay. Huh? Yes. The answers you can find in the this one. You go through that Arvind Narayan book. They have not given directly, but you need to read at least 2-3 pages so that you can answer that. It is a simple numericals only. There is no need to dedicate some time on this to compute. But anyhow, you did. It's fine. I will give you some more things today, so it will be somewhat interesting. Okay. Next, so many things we are discussing, that blockchain, this blockchain, etc. So this is the general classification of the blockchain versions. The blockchain version that came along with the Bitcoin, first cryptocurrency, is blockchain version 1.0, where it supports only cryptocurrencies. So it is a distributed ledger technology for cryptocurrency. So it won't allow you to write any other things. Next one is blockchain version 2.0. Whatever the features available in blockchain 1.0, along with those features, one new feature is also added, which is called smart contract. Basically, this smart contract is not a completely new thing. Internally, in Bitcoin, when the transaction need to be executed or committed, there will be a Bitcoin microcode will be there that will be executed first. That microcode is the business logic to check whether the account number is correct or not, or the required whether the required transaction met the balance of the sender or not, or it is below the sender's balance or not. See, this kind of business logic will be verified with the Bitcoin microcode. That will be done internally. So that same thing has been enhanced to a programming level to implement the business logic, which is called smart contract. So this blockchain 1.0 features plus smart contracts, we can say that is the blockchain version 2.0. So smart contracts are small programs that live in the blockchain, and whenever the certain condition is met, then that particular program will be executed, and this particular program will be executed on all the nodes where this corresponding blockchain will run. So example of that is Ethereum. So Ethereum is a kind of a blockchain version 2.0, which supports the smart contracts and regular blockchain. That is, in Ethereum, you can write smart contracts. At the same time, you can also work with the cryptocurrency called Ether. Next one is blockchain 3.0, it supports the features of the blockchain 2.0, that means earlier versions, plus decentralized application development. That is, here we are going to look for the front-end application development and smart contract development. So here dApp development with Ethereum is a kind of version 3.0. So today I will show you how to do that, but I cannot go in detail of each and everything, but I can give you some information related to that. So this we can do in the Ethereum with the help of Web3.js, and in Hyperledger it is a drag and drop kind of feature. Only a few things we need to type in that. Next one is blockchain 4.0. What are the features of blockchain 3.0 plus industrial applications? On the day 3, speaker has told you that IoT with blockchain, that is blockchain version 4.0. So whatever the applications, general applications are there, plus the industrial applications. So here industrial applications means you may integrate with the IoT devices or some sensors, or maybe RFIDs, or maybe with sensors as the input devices. So blockchain 3.0 plus industrial applications is the blockchain version 4.0. So using blockchain for industry applications such as automation, ERP, etc., especially this blockchain for supply chain management will come under this blockchain 4.0. So these are the different versions we can differentiate, so that you are supposed to decide at which level you want to work. You want to dedicate your development only for the cryptocurrencies or virtual currencies, then version 1.0 is sufficient. And if you want to integrate some smart contracts and all 2.0, then you want to develop decentralized applications 3.0. And if you want to use all the features for the IoT applications or industrial applications or supply chain management related applications, then 4.0 is better one. So this is the way how we can divide these versions. Any doubts so far? Okay. So in blockchain systems, there are three categories mainly, because these are the things essential for us to understand. Then only we can perfectly sketch the blockchain development. The taxonomy of blockchain systems, first one is public blockchain, which is also called permissionless blockchain. Permissionless means the name itself telling you that we no need to take any permission from any authority. So public blockchain, it is open to the world. It attracts many users, and communities are active in this. So example is Bitcoin. So Bitcoin is a public blockchain in which anyone can create an account and go for trading and all. Next one is private blockchain. First I will discuss the private blockchain, then go for consortium blockchain. Private blockchain means it's opposite of public. Here permissionless is there, here permissioned means there is an authority and you have to take the permission from the authority to create an account. Okay. The authority may be the organization in which you want to take the account. For example, if you are running an organization where the applications are on blockchain, and if someone wants to take an account, then they have to take your permission. Then such kind of blockchains are said to be private blockchain. It is for small communities. So many companies are developing frameworks for its efficiency and auditability. Why? In case of public blockchain systems, this efficiency and auditability is a task, is a question, is a important difficulty. Because if you look at it is very famous attack also, which is called ransomware attack. In ransomware attack, what will happen? A virus will be injected into your computer. And that virus, what it will do is, slowly it will encrypt all the files and folders in your hard disk. And after encryption, whenever you want to open any file, then it will ask you that, okay, your file has been encrypted. And if you want to decrypt it, you are supposed to pay a ransom. So that ransom will be paid again in terms of bitcoins. So you will you may pay a huge amount with the help of with the bitcoins, but even though you pay, even after you pay, you don't know who is that hacker who injected the virus in your computer. So here what happens is the anonymity property is perfectly followed in the Bitcoin blockchain, so that the sender don't know who is the receiver and receiver don't know who is the sender. So this is the way how the things will be maintained. So the reason in this case, auditability is a questioning task. So private blockchain, in private blockchain, what happened, since it will be under the control of a singular multiple authorities, so it is very easy for auditing the things. At the same time, it is somewhat efficient in creating the blocks. You look at in case of public blockchain, the block creation in Bitcoin is one block per 10 minutes. That means everyone who are participating in the Bitcoin network must be in a position to achieve a consensus by proof of work, then the block will be created. And the block is of 1 MB size, okay? And if it is 1 MB size, how many transactions will be fitted in the one block? Maximum of 6-7 transactions. If you can say that the transaction is committed and permanently stored on the blockchain only after 6 consecutive blocks were successfully inserted. That means on an average, for every 10 minutes one block is created, means to get confirmation of one transaction, you may take at least 1 hour, means at least 6 blocks to be injected into the blockchain. Then only you can confirm that, okay, this transaction is perfectly committed onto the blockchain. So that means for one transaction, you need to wait for 1 hour to get confirmation. And at the same time, yesterday we have seen in the case of proof of work, we cannot assure that when the pack of or pool of transactions was collected for creating the block, you cannot assure that a certain transaction will be included into a block. The transaction picking is also completely random. So in such a cases, it may not be 1 hour. It may go beyond 1 hour to get your confirmation. So this is somewhat a very slow process. But in case of private blockchain, what happened? Since one or two authorities are there who will do this, it is so efficient. It is very efficient because they decide, okay, whether to create the block or not. If they want to create the block immediately, maybe in 1 minute, 2 minutes, they will create the blocks and will be committed onto the blockchain. So this is what the thing. So that is the reason it is very good for the small communities. Small communities means count can be taken as per your controlling capacity. It may be 100, 50, 200, 300, it may be. But many of the government projects are using this private blockchain. For example, in Andhra Pradesh, previous government has started the CRDA, Capital Region Development Authority, to perform the land pooling from the farmers in that locality. So that land pooling and details was kept on the private blockchain. So at the time, when I am in 17 or 16, I think so. At the time when I started this blockchain concepts, so I have gone through the projects which are already started in our country. In that, this is one thing where private blockchain is implemented. That means total CRDA having the complete authority of committing the blocks. And once it is committed, then no one can change that. So that thereby land documents and these things are permanently saved onto the blockchain. Next one is the consortium blockchain. Here, consortium blockchain, it is it can be applicable to business applications. Here, consortium blockchain is a kind of mixture of public blockchain and private blockchain. It is just like this. Our university, for example, a university is there. A university wants to maintain the things on the blockchain. Say, for example, it may be student records or the publication data of the faculty, or maybe any achievements, or maybe any kind of academic related activities wants to be maintained on the blockchain, including the student fees, everything, and students' certificates, everything want to be maintained on the blockchain. Now, this can be under the control of either vice chancellor, or maybe dean, or head of the department, or maybe dean R&D, or dean academic. So these kind of roles will be there, who are the authorities who are eligible for creating the blocks or committing the blocks. Okay, so in this way, the normal employees and teachers, faculty members, these people don't have any authority to committing the block. Only head of the department, or maybe dean, or maybe higher level people are having the authority to commit the block. So thereby, it is a kind of private blockchain. Okay, thereby it kind of private blockchain. So it will achieve the efficiency and auditability. So everyone knows that, okay, deans are committed the block, or head of the department committed the block. This is clearly visible there. But now, now every year any institution will undergo some one or another kind of inspection. It may be a NBA, NAC, AICT, UGC. So many verifications will be there. Now, assume that AICT or UGC or any other organization, they are also having their own blockchain and want to inspect your proceedings on your university. Now, you should be in a position to give the permission to the outsider. But obviously, AICT and UGC are the outsider to the university. They want to get how you are maintaining the records, or they want to inspect how you are maintaining the records. So temporarily, what you do is you will create an account and you will give it to them, and they will come and verify whether you are maintaining everything properly on the properly or not in the particular academic year, or maybe consecutive 3 years, or maybe any other requirement. So how in this way, it will become a consortium blockchain. Here at university level, it is private only, but it is having a facility to give the permission to others outside of the university to come and see what you want to do it, what they want to inspect at the university level. So thereby it will become a consortium blockchain. So consortium blockchain is not completely public and completely private. It's a mixture of public and private. So this is the way how the consortium blockchain will work. Okay, I hope you have got the how the public blockchain will be decided, consortium blockchain will be decided, and private blockchain will be decided. See, IBM Hyperledger, IBM or Linux founder Hyperledger Composer or Fabric is there, which is completely private blockchain. Okay, and consortium blockchain you can use Ethereum, and for public blockchain you can use Bitcoin related. So only and next one is, if you have only currency support, you don't want any other thing, then you use Bitcoin based blockchains. Okay. Next one is, if you want currency support and smart contracts also, then use Ethereum. If you want only smart contracts to be executed, you are not concerned about the currency, then Linux Foundation Hyperledger. Okay. So Hyperledger don't support the cryptocurrency. But in case of Ethereum, it supports the cryptocurrency, smart contract, at the same time, decentralized application. So as compared to this, that means as an organization, if you want to establish your own virtual currency, at the same time you want to establish your own smart contracts, then I don't think Hyperledger is a suitable thing. So you have to go for any other Hyperledger alternatives to support this cryptocurrencies. But Ethereum will support cryptocurrency in terms of Ether. At the same time, it will support smart contracts. Also have a facility to develop a decentralized application using the smart contracts of the Ethereum. So in any way, Ethereum is finding more advantage in developing the decentralized applications. And Ethereum has a facility of developing the decentralized applications with the help of Web3.js, that is JavaScript as the front end, or Python, or maybe Java. So like that, many other top programming languages can be used for developing the decentralized applications by linking the smart contracts of the Ethereum. Okay, any doubts so far? Okay, so here these are the various blockchain applications. So here the blockchain applications are varied from spreaded over various fields such as finance, IoT, public services, reputation system, security, etc. In finance, many applications can be made with this. And like financial services, peer-to-peer financial markets, insurance markets, enterprise transformation, risk management, all these things can be done under the finance. And in case of IoT, smart contract commissioned device into the cloud ecosystem, or recording of so-and-so events sensed by the sensors. Okay, so all these things can be kept on the blockchain with the help of IoT devices. For example, granite exports. So India is a place for exporting the granite. So our Indian granite have lot of demand outside. So whenever any quarry company or any granite company wants to establish a blockchain, so they can go for this supply chain management related blockchain, but they can also trace when with the help of this IoT devices, like that particular granite may be started via ship, and it may go through the sea route and will go in, may stop in various other places, and finally will reach the long distance. So in middle, how the tracking of the ship is happening, and whether the condition of the material is good or not, is there any difficulty in that material? So I have taken a hard one. This granite and all is, they won't happen, and nothing will happen to that. But in case of like animal exports. Like in animal exports, some animals will be there. They may not adjust to the environment in the sea route, or maybe in any other routes. So these are the things can be tracked with the help of placing sensors to the animals, and sometimes to the food items. And because some food items, whenever you are exporting, it must be kept at some temperature. You may place the temperature sensors in those devices, in those vehicles, or exporting things, and you can keep on tracking the temperature throughout the transit, and these things will be recorded at certain stations whenever it reaches in the during the transit, and these things will be recorded onto the blockchain, so that the order can be tracked anywhere on the blockchain by the merchant and by the purchaser. So this is the way how the blockchain can also be maintained in the supply chain management with the help of IoT devices. See here, IoT devices means some sensor devices will be there. They are linked to the internet, and via internet, whatever the data they include, that will be recorded onto the blockchain, so that a merchant and the merchant at the sending side and purchaser at the receiving side can keep track of the items which are there in the transit. Just like how you are tracking the courier once your friend or relative sent the courier from some other places. So the same concept can be used here with the sensor devices in the IoT plus blockchain. Next one is public services like energy saving. Yesterday we have seen solar coin kind of thing. Like that, you can also develop one kind of application. Solving the water crisis, online education, public domain name systems. So all these things will come under this. Next is reputation system, security, finance. Okay, finance already I discussed. So what are the various blockchain platforms that can be used for implementing this? There are many number of blockchain platforms are there, but we mainly focus on the blockchain platforms that are having more facility of documentation and activeness of the participants in development or something, or activeness of the developing modules. So here Ethereum is one thing that popularity is very high. It is actively followed in GitHub. So obviously when it is actively followed, many developers are interested towards this. Next one is network type, public and smart contract based. And next one is cost, Ether for transaction and computational services are the cost in this. And programming languages, you can use Python, Go, C++, JavaScript for developing the front end applications. But the smart contracts are developed using the Solidity programming. Next one is GitHub repos are there. You can download this Ethereum from any one of the repo. And when I first started this blockchain programming, some expert told me that okay, only around 4,000 to 5,000 in range blockchain programmers are there in India. Maybe it may now its count may be increased to maybe around 50,000 to 60,000. But still, we require some good programmers in blockchain because in near future, if the government adopts blockchain as the main technology to transform the all government services, first, then they need to have more number of blockchain programmers. So that is the reason. Instead of having working on research on this, developing applications will give you more benefit because while developing applications, you need to go through many many things. It is just like a software development lifecycle only. So you need to go through the many things so that you will come to know how to manage or how to design and develop and manage at the same time to install a blockchain application. So maybe next till 10 to 20 years, this blockchain will lead like anything. Then afterwards, maintenance is required. So everything till your retirement, you can go through this blockchain. At the same time, students will also benefit a lot. Okay, when they know the blockchain programming. So still, we require more number of blockchain programmers because if the government initiates the blockchain technology, people are saying that the crisis are coming and all. No, not like that. There are so many other technologies. If they implement, it will transform India like anything. So that is the reason. Government may not directly recruit the students for there, but anyhow, they will give the contract to the companies, and companies in turn will recruit the students or anyone who knows this particular blockchain programming. So next one is Hyperledger. This also popularity is very high, actively updated in GitHub. Network type is both public and private, and it's open source. Next one is programming languages is Python is used here. Okay. Next one is multi-chain. This is also medium and but actively updated in GitHub. Hydra chain. It is somewhat popular, it is low but actively updated in GitHub. Next one is open chain. Popularity is medium but actively updated in the things, and it is a kind of private blockchain. Next one is IBM Bluemix blockchain. It is both private and permissioned blockchain. That is private and consortium kind of blockchain. You can do it. It's not permissioned. I have wrongly typed this. Okay. Next one is pricing is limited free plan. It is just like first first 2 months or 3 months they will give it for free. Then you are supposed to upgrade using enterprise plans. Supported languages are Go and JavaScript. Next one is Chain. It's a medium but actively updated on GitHub, and network type permissioned, and it have the support of programming language support of Java, Ruby, and Node.js. Next is IOTA. It is also a permissioned and public blockchain. Both it supports. And here, the pricing is based upon the IOTA token. You are supposed to take the tokens from IOTA. Depending upon the token's cost, then your usage limit will be decided. So these are the various blockchain platforms available. I have not included Kotra because I have not worked on that Kotra. That is the reason you can also consider Kotra and you can go through that. But I have not worked so far on Kotra. But I only worked on the Hyperledger and Ethereum so far. So I can tell you the information related to the Hyperledger and Ethereum. So that is the reason I am giving you the difference between the Bitcoin versus Ethereum. In Bitcoin, what happens is it's a cryptocurrency and Ether is a token kind of thing. And here in Bitcoin is the currency, and the lowest denomination is Satoshi. Okay, it's just like 1 rupee is equal to 100 paisa. Lowest denomination is 1 paisa. So like that, 1 satoshi is equal to 0.00001 BTC. Where in case of Ether, the lowest denomination is Vay. 1 Vay is equal to this much, 1 Ether. And there are supply capacity is 21 million bitcoins in total, but whereas in case of Ether, 18 million for every year. Okay, and these are the things. And here, currently mining amount is 12.5 BTC, but it will be halved for every 4 years. The reason is it is placed with the intention that as the Bitcoin price go high, even after 4 years, if it is halved, the Bitcoin mining amount is halved, still the miners will get the profit, because the Bitcoin price in the 2016 is around $500 per one Bitcoin. Today, if you look at it, is around $11,000 for one Bitcoin. So obviously, if you maintain the same rate, the traders cannot be in a position to trade or cannot perform the transactions. So that reason they have made a trick of halving the Bitcoin mining fee for every 4 years. So if you look at in the Genesis block, the first Bitcoin when it is mined, first block when it is mined, you might have seen the 50 BTC as the initial amount there. Then after 4 years, it became 25 BTC. Then after 4 years, it became 12.5 BTC. Now in future, it may become half of 12.5 BTC. So like that, it will decrease. Next, in case of Ethereum versus Hyperledger, the Hyperledger is preferred for business to business applications. So that means business to business, in the sense, for example, a diamond traders will be there, or diamond suppliers will be there. The diamond may be extracted in a core form from the diamond ores, and that will be sent to the filtering, and that will be gone for the polishing and all. Then they may be sent to some other countries for cutting and polishing, or maybe any other purpose. So here, to keep track of this diamond transactions over the transit, and at the same time to know the originality and its quality, some standards are required. So at the same time, these standards must be maintained between the business party of who are available in another country and business party who is available at another country. So that is the reason, in order to have the communication between these two businesses in a transparent way, they may use the blockchain such as Hyperledger. So such kind of business activities they can implement with the help of the Hyperledger. So that is the reason Hyperledger is preferred platform for the blockchain applications. And where in case of Ethereum, it is best suitable for the business to customer business applications, and also for the general applications. So these are the e-commerce models, business to business, business to consumer, consumer to consumer, business to government, government to government. These are the various e-commerce models. So wherever you find the e-commerce model as the B2B model, then you can use the Hyperledger, because B2B model is the private blockchain. Hyperledger is a private blockchain. There may be one organizer at one business side, another organizer at the another business side. They will be in charges for committing the blocks. So in that way, they can do this. So next is confidentiality. Confidential transactions will be there. And here, in case of Ethereum, transparent transactions are there. Next is mode of peer participation, private and permission network. In case of Hyperledger, Ethereum is public, private, and permissionless. You can use in any way. Consensus mechanism, pluggable consensus algorithms are there. And here, proof of work algorithms are used here. Sometimes consensus is reached by mining. In case of public, whenever you use it as public. In case of private, it will simply commit like that. Next is programming languages. Chain code, which is written in Go language. You can also use Go language. You can also Go language for developing this Hyperledger programming. Next, in case of smart contracts, in case of Ethereum, are written in Solidity. And cryptocurrency, there is no built-in cryptocurrency for the Hyperledger. In case of Hyperledger, but in Ethereum there is a built-in thing called Ether. As I told you just yesterday and today also, the SHA-256 is used for the Bitcoin and for the hashing purpose. Where in case of Ethereum, Ethash will be used. Ethash is a SHA-3 method that is used by the ETH is a SHA-3 family hashing method that will be used by the Ethereum. So this is the hashing difference, hashing methods difference between the Bitcoin and Ethereum. Any doubts so far? Hello? Yes, sir. Smart contract is especially used whenever all the things were settled between the two parties. Okay, so for example, if you want to undergo a contract of for example maybe a road contract or something, unless until the contract's terms and conditions were agreed by both the parties, it cannot be started. Okay. So that is the reason. First, all the rules and terms and conditions must be read by both the parties and should agree upon on these terms and conditions. Then the work to be started. Whatever the idea you have put before is it is just like giving the tender over a period of time, or giving the best price. Or it's a kind of tendering kind of thing over a period of time. So it varies from application to application. The reason is, for example, there may be a product sold out like a OLX or something. So your idea is, why can't we put some negotiations so that these negotiations can be committed and these kind of things. That is the what idea you have expressed here. Okay, that is the idea you have expressed here. But that depends upon the that depends on the application. Okay, where you implement the application, because if I take my simple supply chain management, the people who are using the who are having the business from long time, they no need of special there is no need of special negotiations, because they have already agreed upon some terms and conditions and they're working. But to improve the transparency, they want to implement. Then in such a cases, your idea may not be applicable. But if a new if a new business is there and they want to do some negotiations, so they can start on this. Because if you look at, I virtually come to know that, but I'm not confirmed in this. I'm not sure in this. The coal auctions recently held, not recently, around 4 or 5 years back, after the Modi government, first in 2014 or 15. They have gone for the coal auctions, coal mine auctions. So all these coal mine auctions, I come to know that it was happened via in a transparent way with the help of the blockchain. I don't know whether it is really on, it's only public hype or media hype or something, but I don't know exactly. So there, what happened is no one knows who are participating in the tender. Okay, they are making their own quotes and all. There is no negotiation. Okay, there is no kind of personal contact and negotiation, but it was everything was recorded on the blockchain, and finally everything will be settled with the help of an algorithm, and finally the auctions were granted and tenders were granted. So I feel it is different from the application to application. Is your question answered? Okay. Okay. Now we'll mainly focus on when to use the blockchain. Is the screen visible? When to use the blockchain? Okay. So far we have seen the taxonomy of the blockchain and blockchain versions, and we have seen, because I have highlighted, because I know Ethereum and Hyperledger, that is the reason I have highlighted Ethereum and Hyperledger. There may be any other blockchains available. Then now I am coming to when to use the blockchain. Is it shall we use the blockchain simply like that, or is there any instruction to use the blockchain? Because if you look at our students will be there, mostly they will do the projects in such a way that even though that method is not required to implement there, simply they will implement the thing for the beautiful graphs. So if the things are not required to implement there, then it is not required. It is no need of implementing there. So first of all, you should know where to implement and where not to implement. Mostly, like for example, for the dimensionality reduction in machine learning, simply they will use the principal component analysis, even though they have 6 to 8 features. So this PCI is usually especially beneficial when you have more number of features. So, but students, what they will do is, I have implemented PCI, I have implemented this one, that one. But where the things are not required, you don't need to implement that. So like that, first of all, you, as a blockchain developer, you should know where the blockchain is to be implemented. So first is, I have developed this flowchart after listening to so many other, after reading so many papers. Virtually, maybe one or another way, it may meet with some other things. Start the project. First question to be asked is, can't rely on the trusted third party? You don't want to rely on third party. For example, banking system is there. You don't want to rely on the banking system, because yourself and a banker, and is there any third party is there? Can't you rely on that? If the answer is no, that is I can't cannot rely on, means I cannot rely on the trusted third party, then you need to move on to the next stage. Yes, if the answer is yes, that is yes, I can rely on the trusted third party, then blockchain is not required. Okay, so once this question is answered successfully, there itself you can decide that okay, whether to use the blockchain or not. When you have the trust on the third party, then blockchain is not required. Okay, if you don't have rely on third party, then move on to this. Is data to be stored and database is required? And that is, whatever the transactions and this kind of things are to be stored somewhere, and it should be persisted, and it should be mutable, or this kind of thing. If that is not required, then blockchain is not required. If that is required, that is data storage is required, then move to the next decision. Are multiple writers exist? That means multiple stakeholders or roles that will come into the blockchain development or blockchain writing or transaction writing or committing or what may be. If it is yes, then go for next decision. If it is no, then there you can drop there itself. Blockchain is not required. Next one is multiple writers. Writers are unknown, untrusted, and have conflict of interest. If they have that is, writers are unknown, means you don't know who is the other writer, because if you implement any blockchain, there may be one authority today. After 2-3 years, he may retire, or he may go out and some new person may come. So in this way, the keep on changing, or sometimes in case of Bitcoin networks like public blockchain, you don't know who is the writer and who is entering into the system and who is leaving the system. In such a cases, if the answer is yes, then go to the next decision. If answer is no, then blockchain is not required. Next, once you pass through these four decision phases, then move on to the another decision phase. Do you require access control? Access control in the sense, it is just like access control in the operating system. Administrator is having highly privileged, and he is having complete access to the system, and he may give the read permissions, write permissions, or commit permissions, maybe any other permissions to other users. Like such kind of access control is required. If it is required, then go to the next decision. If it is not required, you go to the another decision. We'll go in one part. Okay, one part. Access control is not required. Yes. Then are transactions public? Do you want to make all the transactions public so that anyone can view the transaction? If it is yes, then go to next decision stage. That is, whether these transactions must be immutable, and do you want to look at any efficiency trade-off? That means, as I told you just now, creation of the number of blocks per hour or blocks per for every 10 minutes or something, thereby how the efficiency decreased. So if do you want this kind of efficiency and immutability trade-off, then if your answer is yes, then move to the public blockchain. In all these three decision stages, if the answer is no, then answer another question. Is multi-party consensus required? If multi-party consensus required, that means, as I told you an example, such as university example. Here, a faculty has entered the data into the blockchain application, and this particular blockchain application must be first scrutinized by the head of the department. Once it is scrutinized by the HOD, then it will be scrutinized by the dean, then to the vice chancellor. So like this, multi-party consensus required. Or if the UGC or AICTE wants to verify are provide his their own consents on the board of studies decision, or maybe maybe the academic academic activities they have developed, or maybe syllabus or curriculum structure they have structured. So like that, consensus is required from the outside, or here multi-party consensus is required. Then if it is answer is yes, then go for the consortium blockchain. Otherwise, then go for the private blockchain. Here only one person will be there who is the hero of that blockchain. He always keep on committing the blocks. So this is the way you are supposed to decide which blockchain to be, which blockchain to be used. So first one is, first question you need to answer is, can't you rely on the trusted third party? If you can't rely, then move to the other decision. If you can rely, then don't require blockchain. The blockchain is not at all required. Here itself you can close this decision. Next is, database is required. Then if the database is required and multiple writers exist, and you don't know who are the writers and having conflict of interest, then you move on to the another further three conditions and answer these three conditions. If the answer of these three conditions are yes, then go for the public blockchain. Otherwise, check before moving on to the deciding on next two blockchains like private and consortium blockchain. Answer another condition is multi-party consensus required. If it is required, then go for consortium blockchain. Otherwise, go for the private blockchain. Any doubts so far? Is it clear when to use blockchain? Okay, thank you. So this is the, now you come to know that what are the blockchain taxonomies, what are the blockchain versions, and when to use the blockchain, whether can you do anything on the blockchain or not, or a particular problem can be implemented on the blockchain or not. These are the things that we have seen. Now, so this is the guidelines for choosing the blockchain projects. This is the only guidelines. So blockchain as a new technology, it is attracting huge demand in industry and academia. Few use cases in various industries: financial services, public sector, retail, insurance, supply chain, logistics. You may extend this list. Okay, however, I have collected these lists, and last time to my MTech students I have given different cases that they started working on that, and finally they have done some good job on this. Almost every two members I have formed a group, and they have submitted a very good document at the end of the semester. So like this, these are the ideas got out of the discussion with the students and over the various internet channels and all. You may extend this afterwards. You may extend the list, and if you have more number of if you find more areas, you please also communicate me so that I will also include in this. Anyhow, there exists I will give you one link afternoon where you will find a huge base of the blockchain case studies. So whatever you think, that will be available in that particular repository. If it is not there, then your idea is very new. So like that you can decide. Okay, I will give you in afternoon section. So these are the list of areas where you can implement the blockchain for that. So this is the simple diagram I have already shown you. So how to start with the blockchain product? That is, start with small model. Don't assume a huge model first. So in software development lifecycle, in software engineering, usually people will feel boring whenever they say software engineering. But all the software engineering principles that you can use in blockchain development. So here, start with a small model, like start with a few users, features, functionalities, first decide the functional requirements. Okay, always first decide the functional requirements. First, thoroughly brainstorm the functional requirements, list the functional requirements. Then add slowly new features to scale to the large extent. So that reason, the suitable model, according to the software development lifecycle, suitable model for the blockchain product development is spiral model. You cannot do everything from everything within at one stretch. Next one is how to understand the business problem. First is what are the specific business problems, challenges, and first project will address. So that is what they call scope of the business challenges to address. That need to be decided first. This will come only via brainstorming. Okay. So even though you have a good idea, you feel that it is a good idea. Okay. Don't decide yourself what to do. Always you sit along with the like-minded people and discuss with them. Okay. And some people will be there. Simply they will steal your ideas and will do some other thing in some other places. So don't encourage such people. But you think, if you feel that, okay, the first thing, whether the third party is trusted or not. First you check whether the third party is trusted or not. You decide and discuss with them. Okay. So that thereby you can develop the functional requirement. Okay. So what is the current way of solving the business problem? Whether solving the problem, this particular problem, via establishing a centralized server or whatever, any other means. So that you need to investigate first, then you can go for implementing on the blockchain. So that means complete understanding of the current system and areas for improvement. What are the other areas which cannot be addressed with the current system that you are supposed to decide? Assuming the business problem is large, what specific aspects of the business problem will be addressed? So you may list various business problems, but all problems cannot be addressed in one stretch. So you may do in stages. As I have shown you yesterday, the Singapore business blockchain bank, they have decided that where I have to get this. The Singapore blockchain bank. So here they have mentioned project phases. You look at here. What are the project phases? First phase is tokenized SGD, reimagining RTGS, delivery versus payment. Next, cross-border payment versus payment, enabling broad ecosystem collaboration. So that means they have divided the entire project into phases. Like that, you should also divide the problem into the phases. Assuming the business problem is large, the specific aspects of the business problem will be addressed. That need to be decided first. And divide the work into phases. Next one is who are the business network participants involved, and what are their roles? Okay, if there is no business network involved, then this is not a good use case. Okay, that means there should be some business transaction. Business should be there. Otherwise, there is no distributed ledger. There is no transaction. Obviously, there is no distributed ledger if there is no transaction. Next is who are the specific people within the organization, and what are their job roles, and who is responsible for controlling the blockchain? All these things should be discussed first. Understanding the key users in the blockchain business network. Okay. Next one is understanding the participants. That means who are the stakeholders? Who are the participants? How many type of participants are there? Who will they access and interact with the blockchain? Who will control the blockchain, and how they will access and interact with the blockchain? Here, access and interact means whether they can be in a position to access with the help of web application or mobile application. Okay, that you need to decide first. Next, will they be peer nodes? Do we need to mobile or sorry, that is the same thing. Do we need web or mobile apps that need to be checked? Are gateways such as exchanges and data providers needed? Do you need to integrate the external data sources? Who will operate the blockchain? And is there any government or other regulatory bodies will come into the picture? Okay, for example, if the bank is operating the blockchain, then RBI will come into the picture. So like that. So what is the value or incentive for each participant to join the network? If they join the network, what is the incentives to be given, or what is the deposits, or what are the things they need to place for the joining into the network? So these are the things you are supposed to check. Next is participant identities. Do you need to know your users? That is, whether the users can be anonymous and they can do anything. Pseudo-anonymous blockchain like Bitcoin does not require the identities to be verified, obviously. In most business use cases, some form of identity is required. Either maybe a identity such as government identities, or maybe your Aadhaar card number or this kind of thing. First of all, some KYC is required to start an account. So like that, source can come from government, financial institutions, or utility providers. So like that, what are the identities to be maintained with the participants? Next is understanding the assets and transactions. What are the assets to be used in the thing, and what are the transactions to be used in this? Such as, next one is defining the transactions. If you might have listed the transactions that are generally happen in the network, you have to define those transactions. What type of process needed to take place in your business blockchain network? It invokes the action like adding, deleting, change, transfer, record on the blockchain. Whether you are querying the blockchain or not. Do you need control access to the functions based upon the participant types in the roles? So all these things should be addressed. What are the main steps in the current flow, and how are these executed by the business network participants? What is the expected benefit of applying business technology to the business problems for each of the network participants? The legacy system are involved, and because many companies who are having their establishment from long years, then obviously legacy systems are involved. For example, mainframes are there. Mainframes was not started today. It was there in 1980s, 1985 or something. So from that time, the people are using mainframes. But if they want to turn directly into the blockchain, whether the legacy systems will support the change or not. So all these things, what is the level of degree of integration of the legacy systems is required in this? All these things need to be addressed. Finally, in software engineering, the first step of any software development is the feasibility study. The feasibility study is it worth doing or not? First, we need to always check that whether is it important to do it or not. That is called cost-benefit analysis. Business systems is costly than regular centralized systems. The reason is, if any mistake was done in the smart contract, it will lead to a huge disaster. Okay? So that is the reason it is very costly than the regular centralized system. Regular centralized systems are very good because already established, they replace that, and other security features will be established. Some system administrator or server administrators will be there. They will place IDS and other security features in that, and they will go into that. But here in blockchain system, many logic programmings will be done, smart contract programs will be done. So that is the reason this is somewhat a costly effort. Costly in terms of maybe in terms of reputation, maybe in terms of the money, or maybe any other thing. But it is a somewhat costly effort. So these are the things that you are supposed to address when you are choosing the blockchain project. So far, any doubt? Any doubt so far? Okay. Now, what I will do is, now I will give you one case study. Okay. All of you, please take a pen and paper. And Or shall I will open on the desktop itself so that you can go through that. I have shared you a screen in which you will find a case study. Please go through this case study. I will give you 5 to 10 minutes. Please go through the case study.
See, please go through the case study that I have provided here. Okay, let remaining people answer so that I can proceed. So once you've gone through this, otherwise you take screenshot of this, the questions to be answered here like this. Answer the following questions with the proper justification. Does the implementation of the blockchain benefit the above case? What is the type of blockchain suggested in the above case? Identify the roles, stakeholders in these cases. Define the responsibility of the roles and stakeholders. Is there any possibility of using smart contract in these cases? If so, list them with proper logic. List functional requirements of these cases. So I have given two cases in this. I have shown only one case. So that is the reason I have written cases like that. Okay. In your opinion, what are the security and audit procedures that need to be incorporated in these cases? And the last two are the smart contract development using programming language, and show step by step plan of integrating the smart contract code with the DApps that we'll see afterwards. If time permits, we'll see this. So you may take the snapshot of these questions. Okay. So the first case is a fresh graduates who they plan to start up a firm called E-Ride. E-Ride in the sense they want to provide electric scooters for rent in metro cities, where if anyone want to travel between one metro station to other metro station or to any other place. So there will be an office at the metro station with around 10 to 15 electric scooters like that, so that they can avail the electric scooter and they can go to nearest metro station office and they can deposit there. So this is the idea behind this. The initial idea is to establish the office near to the metro station. Customers can pick up scooters from any metro station and can leave at any metro station. Customers need to ride the scooters by themselves. That is called this e-ride firm started both web and mobile based applications. That means customers can use either mobile application or web application to interact with the system to avail the services by the customers. To avail services, first customer need to register in the app by providing valid identity. Valid identity means it may be a government given identity like Aadhaar card or in PAN card or something. An account opening fee of rupees 1000 and a minimum deposit fee of 1000 means total 2000 must be placed at the creation of the account, in which 1000 is opening fee and 1000 must be there as the minimum balance. Always customer need to maintain rupees 1000 as the minimum deposit fee in the account to avail the service. Upon opening the account, an account number will be issued with an e-card. There is an e-card will be there, so they can show that e-card anywhere, or that e-card consisting of a QR code, and just by simply showing the QR code to the QR scanner at the office level, it will automatically record the data. And that entry will be recorded into the system. The customer can search for the availability of scooters via the apps. So they can, when they are getting down to the metro station, they can check whether scooters are available or not via app. The registered customer will get 10% discount on each ride which made above 10 kilometers. So if the customer went above 10 kilometers, then whatever the prescribed per kilometer price, on that 10% discount will be given to them, and that amount will be debited automatically from the deposited amount. Once it is debited from the deposited amount, a e-bill will be generated. That means that in that app only he can see that e-bill. That is related to the amount will be related amount will be deducted from the minimum deposit fee, and that bill will be automatically appeared into the app. Either he can view via web application or mobile application, and GST of each bill is automatically credited to the government account. So here, if you won't pay GST, Modi ji will be angry. So I have added GST here. And GST of each bill is automatically credited to the government account. Now here, what are the roles will come into the picture? Here customer is there, e-rate firm is there, government is there. Now you think of what is the suitable blockchain. First of all, blockchain is required or not in this? First question is, blockchain is required or not? Next one is, if it is required, what type of blockchain is required?
Okay.
Any other, sir? Okay. Okay. हाँ, दिस इज इम्पोर्टेंट. हाँ, फर्स्ट दे हैव टू डिपॉजिट देयर आइडेंटिटी कार्ड. ओके, आइडेंटिटी कार्ड मस्ट बी गिवन एंड दैट इज गवर्नमेंट रिकॉग्नाइज्ड आइडेंटिटी शुड बी गिवन. हाँ, ओके. Okay, so here the recommended blockchain is Consortium blockchain. Okay, so we need to go through the what you call this one, the flowchart that I have given, in which multiple is there any conflict of interest between the participants? Is there any immutability versus efficiency trade-off, and all these things we need to check. After analyzing all these things, we will feel that okay, public blockchain is not suitable for this. Here it is like a consortium blockchain, because even customer cannot also trust this, and the e-ride is also responsible for the government to pay the tax. So that is the reason for the between the e-ride and customer, it is private. But government has the authority to see the whether they have paid the taxes correctly or not, and at the same time the customer can also see whether the taxes has been correctly deducted from his account or not via e-bills and all. So the reason here third party will come only at one level, that is called at the tax level, that is government will come into the picture only at the collection of tax. So this is the way we can decide it as a consortium blockchain. Next, I will show you another case. You may take screenshot of this. Because in the earlier case, the amount reduction, GST reduction, or GST deposition, or amount to be checked, everything can be implemented with the help of smart contracts. Because this is the business logic. If you go above 10 kilometers range with that particular thing, then certain 10% of discount will be given. So this is the kind of condition. If you might have crossed 10 kilometers then and deposited full amount and with all the perfect registrations, then it's fine. See here, the amount is very small that I have mentioned. Usually electric scooters are somewhat costly. You may increase the amount in future, but for a simple understanding I have mentioned the small amount here. Yes. You do whatever you want, but again it should be deposited at the office only. No problem. Just for understanding, I have mentioned that case. We can improve it like anything. Okay. You may take on basis of time or distance. Okay, that only. No, I told you, no, you can improve like this, anything. Obviously many taxes will do like that only time basis. That is also good point. You can also include it. Just for understanding I have shown you this.
you can slowly improve it.
Now, second case is purely based upon the Ethereum blockchain. Here, Y is there, no? Y means it's the lowest denomination of the Ether. You assume it as a 500 rupees. Instead of 500 Ys, you assume it as 500 rupees. Just like that. So we all are aware of the multi-level marketing. We might have seen so many people selling their products, okay, and asking them to take our products and all. Okay, this kind of multi-level producting. A product manufacturing company wants to promote their products using multi-level marketing. The structure of multi-level marketing is as follows. Anyone who is interested in multi-level marketing should first get approval from company's marketing manager and can start the marketing office. Company has fixed rupees 500, here 500 wise I have written, for our understanding, rupees 500 as a franchise fee. The franchise can build small groups for daily marketing purpose. Franchise can join members in group. In addition, the approved group member can also join any other in it. For this, a new entrant need to pay rupees 500, so rupees 100, here 100 ways I have mentioned, for our understanding, I am saying this rupees 100 as joining fee. If franchise joined the new entrant in the group, then 100% joining fee is directly credited to his or her account. Otherwise, 30% of the joining fee is credited to the franchise and remaining 70% is credited to the group member who joined the new entrant. So that means if you join another new person and based upon the fee received by that person, the sharing will be done to the franchise and the group member. The same share is applicable on the products sold by the franchise and group members. Further, the maximum group size is fixed to 50. So this is the thing, you see, this is mostly happening in our general life. Many people will come and ask you to take the products, and it's kind of multi-level marketing. I don't want to specify a particular company. We all know that company. Okay. So and here, if you look at lastly, I have given a hint. Further, the maximum group size is fixed to 50. Let you assume that it is 20 or 25 also. You reduce it, no problem. Because if group size is too large, managing is difficult. So the reason some limit should be placed on the group size. So what is the suitable blockchain for this? Well, any other answer? Okay, fine. So the best suitable recommended architecture is private blockchain, because here there is no third party, only company and the group members, customers, or franchise. So they are not accountable to the government or any other thing. Okay, they. Very limited. It is for small communities. Okay, so private blockchain is recommended for this case. So this is the way you are supposed to identify whether the blockchain and what type of blockchain need to be selected for the case. And once it is done, then does implementation of blockchain benefit the above cases? Okay, yes, surely they will benefit, but there should be clear definition of the roles and responsibilities. Must be mentioned, because customer should be in a position to trace his e-bills. Customer should be in a position to trace his. In case of second case, should be in a position to get to know what is the commission he got, okay, and how many products he sold. So everything must be clearly mentioned. Otherwise, if anything was gone wrong, you cannot go and complain anywhere or something. So that is the reason these rules must be clearly defined first. For that, some brainstorming is required. So, in order to ease the brainstorming, I have provided some questions previously. You need to answer those questions. Then you will get the required requirements. So, what type of blockchain suggested? That we have already answered this. Identify the roles and stakeholders in these cases. That is the next question you are supposed to do it. Next is define the responsibility of the roles or stakeholders. Is there any possibility of using smart contract in these cases? Yes, obviously many places are there where you can use the smart contracts. Next is, if so, list them with proper logic. And list the functional requirements of these cases. Okay, once if you have done these six, in order to do these six, obviously what you are supposed to do is, you need to answer these guidelines. Look at here, how to understand the business problem, whatever the questions are there, you need to answer these questions. Understanding the participants, you need to understand each and every participant in the thing, and participant identities, understanding the assets and transactions. In the first case, the asset is the bike, e-bike, and the journey time or distance, whatever you take as asset. Defining transaction, what is the general transaction will happen, and on the transaction itself there are some four questions. So these things must be answered, then only you will go to this, you can answer these six questions first. There is a list of functional requirements. Once you answer all the questions perfectly, then functional requirements menu can be listed properly. Then while answering all these questions, you may come across some possible security breaches. So in your opinion, what are the security and audit procedures that need to be incorporated in these cases? So first seven steps have been done correctly, then you can start developing the smart contract or developing the product, blockchain product. So that is, develop the smart contract using Solidity or Hyperledger Composer. Show the step-by-step plan of integrating the smart contract code with the DApps. So this is what thing. Any questions from the participants? No problem.
Okay, whenever it is just like whenever you want to whenever a block to be committed or to be signed, it will be signed by the concerned authority using his private key. Okay, whenever he committed using the private key, obviously he is responsible for that. Then no one is having the private key of that person. Okay. See, intentional frauds, what can we do in this? Okay. Later they see, for example, in the regular case, if they might have committed a fraud, okay, how many frauds are going to be punished in the court? Okay, it is very difficult to prove them because some documents will be missed, or they may forge some document, they may fire some documents. But in case of blockchain, you cannot do all these things. I don't think so. Okay. There may be some other feature. See, other than immutability, there is a. See, in regular distributed architecture means what? I am not getting what you want to convey. What is the application? Tell me one application so that I can understand. Two-step factor is different. Two-factor authentication is different. Two-factor authentication means you will log in from the web application and you will get an OTP, then only that thing will happen. For example, head of the department approved this, then dean has to approve this. Then VC has to approve this, right? Multi-level authentication is there. See, in a hierarchy, one may be fraud, not all, no? So now what is your take on this? I'm not getting it. Then it is better to use public blockchain. Then private blockchain it is not possible. Okay, all participants, I am sharing a link. This is a Google Drive link. In this link, I have placed all documents. Okay, I am somewhat because I have placed all the documents in the link that I am providing now, in which you will find a virtual machine which is of around 6 GB. Okay, if your internet is fast and if you are in a position to download that, it is better to download for the next session. The reason is that particular virtual machine image consisting of all softwares that I am going to explain in the next section. And this virtual machine can be used straight away for your lab purpose. Okay, so my recommendation is if you have a good internet speed, better you download by the time. Okay, by the next I request the organizers, you please take this link and also post on to the WhatsApp group if it is there. Okay, so that they will also get this particular link.
Okay. I have already posted onto the chat box. You can take that. There are two folders, day one and day two. In day one, the day one related files were placed, and day two related files are there. And there is a folder called Bodhi Linux. You go to the Bodhi Linux folder, you will find the Linux virtual machine image and virtual machine setup instruction that I will discuss in the next section. So before that, what you do is you download it. If your internet speed is good and you can you're in a position to download it. And one more thing is, please attend the next section, because once you got the material, some people will leave. I know some people will leave when they get the material. But my recommendation is attend the next section, so that I will explain each and everything that I have placed in that, so that you can use that image directly for the lab purpose. And also you may install the same in your the colleges also, or you may give it to the students also. Because if you are doing things from scratch, you may get some compatibility issues or some other thing. And people, Saini Nayak, they have Abu Bakr Muhammad, they have asked to give the documentation guidelines and all. I have already there. All these documentation guidelines are already there in this. Please go through the day two, in which you will find guidelines for choosing the blockchain projects, installing this smart contract case studies and all. You please go through the day two, in which you will find that. Okay. So we'll meet at 2 o'clock sharp. Okay. Madam, you please forward this link to the WhatsApp group. Okay, ma'am. Thank you. We'll meet at 2 o'clock. Sorry, 1 o'clock. Okay. Sorry. Yeah.
Thank you.